there's a presence and an atmosphere here like never before. God, show us. Show us. Unleash everything you have in the heavens for us today, God. We want to hear you. We want to see you more clearly. Help us to know it's you. This is kind of a new song for me. Amanda has done it when she's been here with you guys, and this week it's really, this song is just hit me. It's good. With all the stuff that's happened this week, God's coming back. We can't stop it. We can't deny it. We can deny it, but it's going to happen anyway. He's coming back. And every knee's going to bow. Every tongue's going to confess. Why don't we get him to do it now before then?
Thank you.
We thank you for breaking chains. God, for those things that we're still holding on to, those chains we continue to pick up, I pray, Father, today we lay them down. I pray this is the day that we release those. God, that you break those off of us and we say, yes, God, we want your freedom and your power in our life. Thank you for fighting battles for us. We love you. We love you, and thank you for your love for us.
Worship God with communion. This is World Communion Sunday, and I just want to give you some brief directions about what we're doing here. In our church, we have open communion. Any believer in Christ, you're welcome to come and partake. We're going to have the altar open. If you need to come and pray, if you want to come and do some business with God, we've got some folks here that are going to help us serve the communion, and I'm going to serve them momentarily. If our tech team and our band, any of those members would like to come down, they can come down and come through first. And we'll let them participate in communion. We also have the basket here, and we use that as donations to the less fortunate. And that's how we help people in our church with benevolence. You know, if we have people that come in that are homeless, they're hungry, or they need a place to stay, we're able to help the community with that. Now let's read, and let's see what Jesus said in Matthew 26 about communion. Jesus took some bread, and he blessed it, and he broke it in pieces, and gave it to the disciples, saying, take this and eat it, for this is my body. And he took a cup of wine, and he gave thanks to God for it. He gave it to them and said, each of you drink from it, for this is my blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people. It is poured out as a sacrifice to forgive the sins of many. Father God, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the new covenant that you did die on the cross of Calvary, that you paid our sin debts, and that we have this opportunity today to worship you, to remember what you did for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
Thank you. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me.
Sing on.
Spirit of the living God.
ushers are going to come now, and we're going to continue to worship God with our giving. And we're talking about giving. It's a matter of the heart now, and that's something that we're going to talk about many different things besides just bringing our resources financially to give. And I want to read from Luke chapter 6, verse 38. Give and you will receive. Your gift will return to you in full, pressed down, shaken together to make room for more, running over and poured into your lap. The amount you give will determine the amount you give back. And our ushers are going to come now, and we're going to give back to God what He's given to us. But you know, we can't outgive Him. So no matter what you bring, whatever you return to Him, the tithe belongs to Him, and anything over and above that is an offering. He's going to give it back to us, and He's going to press it down. It's going to be shaken. It's going to run over, and we're going to have even more than enough in abundance, because that's the kind of Heavenly Father we serve. So let me pray for our offering. Father God, I just thank you for this day. I thank you that every good and perfect gift comes from you, the Father of lights above. And I thank you for those obedient givers who bless this house and allow us to do ministry. God, I ask that you would just bless them physically, relationally, emotionally, spiritually, and financially. And we'll give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The church, also known as the body of Christ, contrary to what you may have heard, it is not the building we meet in.
The body of Christ is made up of those who have accepted Jesus as their personal Savior. This body is a unit and is comprised of many parts. There are limbs, organs, and various members that, when assembled, make up the entire body. No one part is greater than the other.
As a member of this body, you have been created to play a role in God's church. You are His hands and feet to bring glory to His name. Each of us was uniquely designed by God with talents, gifts, skills, and abilities.
The way you're wired is not an accident. God didn't give you your abilities for selfish purposes. They were given to serve others.
We don't serve in order to obtain God's mercies, but because as Christians we already have them. Grace leads to service offered out of devotion to Christ.
The motive for our service is love. Our love for God is proved in our love for others. Love and grace lead to serving the other person rather than being served.
Through serving, we glorify God, build up the church body, and reach out to others. Jesus Himself took the form of a servant and did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give His life as a ransom for many.
Too often our mind is set on how another person should serve us, but that is the opposite of what true service is meant to be. Simply put, service at its best is worship.
Here at Calvary Chapel Cardinal, we believe that service in the church is vital. The body needs everybody's help. As Christians, we are directed to serve, and this is one of the ways we worship God. We want to help you to be fruitful and fulfilled in a meaningful place of service. Our desire is that every Christian engage in the work of Christ according to the gifts and passions given to them by the Holy Spirit. We serve God by serving others. We love Him by loving others. That is the church.
Welcome to Giving, a Matter of the Heart. This is a part one of a multi-week series. I believe I'll be in here for about 4 weeks with you guys, and 1 week in the traditional service coming up in a few weeks. But I love that video, and I thought that just talks about so much that I'm going to talk about today, and it shows you so many different ways and examples that you can serve in the church. You know, we can give in so many different ways, not just financially. Sometimes that may be the easiest thing for us to do, is to take some money or to take a check and drop that in the offering plate. But you know, we're the body of Christ. We're the hands and the feet of Christ. We have talents, gifts, and abilities that God has given us. And that grace that He's shown us should lead us to service out of a devotion to Christ. You know, they said love and grace lead to serving the other person. And that glorifies God. You know, Jesus was the ultimate servant, they pointed out there. And service at its best is worship. And that was Calvary Chapel Cardinal in Algonquin, Illinois, that did that video. And I'm so thankful that they have that publicly for us to be able to use that here today in our service. You know, every Christian should be serving others. We should find in our hearts and our minds a way that we can give back, and we can give back by helping others. You know, giving is defined as to make a present of, to give a doll to a child would be an example of that, or to grant or bestow by formal action. The law gives citizens the right to vote, or to accord or yield to another, give him or her confidence, or to put in the possession of another for his or her use, gave me his phone number, or to administer as a sacrament, as we gave out the bread and the juice earlier in our service during the communion service. So when we give our talents, we serve others. And many have given the ultimate sacrifice serving our country, and that reminds me of a little Johnny story that I heard. One Sunday morning, the pastor noticed little Johnny was staring up at a large plaque that hung in the foyer of the church. The seven-year-old had been staring at the plaque for some time, so the pastor walked up, stood beside the boy, and said quietly, "Good morning, son." "Good morning, pastor," replied the young man, focused on the plaque. "Sir, what is this?" Johnny asked. "Well, son, these are all the people who have died in the service," replied the pastor. Soberly, they stood together, staring at the large plaque. Little Johnny's voice barely broke the silence when he asked quietly, "Which one, sir? The 8:30 or the 10:45 service?" I actually got more laughs than I thought it would. If that joke didn't kill you, let's go forward. Let's take a look at our main verses today. They're found in Romans 12. If you got your Bibles, you got your iPad, your tablets, your iPhone, your Android device, if you're unsaved, whatever you might have there that you can follow along. Just kidding. Androids are okay. That's what you like. And I'm reading out of the New Living Translation, starting in verse 1. "And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. Because of the privilege and authority God has given me, I give each of you this warning. Don't think you're better than you really are. Be honest in your evaluation of yourselves. Measure yourselves by the faith God has given us. Just as our bodies have many parts, and each part has a special function, so it is with Christ's body. We are many parts of one body, and we all belong to each other. In his grace, God has given us different gifts for doing certain things well. So if God has given you the ability to prophesy, speak out with as much faith as God has given you. If your gift is serving others, serve them well. If you are a teacher, teach well. If your gift is to encourage others, be encouraging. If it is giving, give generously. If God has given you leadership ability, take the responsibility seriously. And if you have a gift for showing kindness to others, do it gladly. Don't just pretend to love others, really love them. Hate what is wrong, hold tightly to what is good. Love each other with genuine affection, and take delight in honoring each other. Never be lazy, but work hard and serve the Lord enthusiastically. Rejoice in our confident hope. Be patient in trouble, and keep on praying. When God's people are in need, be ready to help them. Always be eager to practice hospitality." Let me pray for your understanding before we go forward. Father God, I thank you for your word. I thank you for the book of Romans. God, I thank you that today you love us so much, God, that you gave Jesus Christ to pay every sin we have ever sinned, God, on the cross of Calvary. I pray that today, if there's one here that doesn't know Jesus and that salvation, that today would be their day of salvation. But God, I pray for the believers in this room as well, that they would hear your word. They'd have ears to hear, eyes to see it, and hearts that are receptive and obedient. And God, help us all to utilize the gifts, the talents, and the abilities that you've given us to serve you and your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, let's break that down now. Let's dig in a little deeper to those 13 verses. And let's see what each one of them can tell us in the Word of God. If you got your teaching notes, you got your pen, your paper, you got your crayon, you got your pencil, whatever you're going to use, get ready. Fill these in and be ready to go home, and you can study this further during the week as you study the Word of God. But verse 1 says, "And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him." So your first fill in the blanks, give your body to God as a living sacrifice by what you do and what you don't do. You know, it's important. It's important what we do because the Word of God gives us the instructions, tells us what we can do and what we can't do. And then He also gives us the Holy Spirit inside of us to guide us in what we should do and what we shouldn't do. When it's not written down in black and white in the Word, He gives us the Comforter to go with us on a daily basis to help us to do the right thing, to help us be that living sacrifice. It's hard sometimes to be a living sacrifice because unlike the altars in Israel, when they would lay the animal up there and they would slay it, that animal was still. It wouldn't move anymore. But we're moving. We're still alive, and we're still doing what we want to do at times. And the flesh can get wrapped up into the spirit, and it can mess us up. But, you know, just let me say this before we go any further today. You know, you can't do anything to make God love you anymore. God loves you so much. He loves you so much, each and every one of us. You know, you won't get more righteous by serving in the church. You know, that's the ask today. We're going to ask you to serve. We're going to ask you to sign up. You know, we've got the card here in the seat when you walked in. And that's why that card's there, you know. But that's not going to make you any more righteous. Your salvation is not based upon what we do, but by what He did for us already. You know, our Heavenly Father loves you. Just like I love my son and my daughter, Zach and Addie can never do anything to make me love them any less. I might be irritated with them at times. They may do some things that really, you know, can anger me and upset me. But that's not going to make me stop loving them. You know, and if we love like that as human fathers and mothers, how much more does our Heavenly Father have perfect love for us? And He's not going to stop loving us. He's going to love us. And He feels that strongly about us as His children. So, you know, there's nothing that we can do to make Him love us more. And there's nothing we can do to make Him love us less. But even so, just like I'm prouder of Zach and Addie when they're very obedient. And if we're parents in here, we can understand that. When our children are obedient, they're doing what they're supposed to do. That makes us happy. That makes us even more proud of them. That doesn't really make us love them more, but at that moment in time, we feel like we love them more. And we want to reward that obedience, don't we, as parents? Obedience equals blessing. Well, it's the same all the way through this Bible, too. If we'll obey the Word of God and we'll be obedient Christians to what He tells us to do in here, it's a foolproof manual for blessing. Because if you do what this Bible tells you to do, and you don't do what this Bible tells you not to do, you can't help but be blessed. You're going to have blessings poured out all over your life because it's what He wants is the best for us. Just as earthly fathers and mothers, we want what's best for our children. But we're not going to reinforce bad behavior, hopefully, as parents. You know, He's not going to do that with us either. He will allow us to get outside of that hedge of protection at times, for us to get a little bit of that spanking to come back in and to do the things that we know we should be doing. So He won't be mocked, but at the same time, He wants what's best for us. But He gives us that free will to choose to do it. So number two, verse two, don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. So your second point, the Word of God will transform our thinking and help us to learn God's perfect will for our lives, including what our gifting is to serve in the kingdom. If we'll get into this Word and if we'll let it change our minds, it'll change your heart. And then that starts changing your actions. If you're walking in this direction and you're going in the wrong direction and it's away from God, if you get into the Word, it will turn you back around if you'll obey it. And it'll start putting you on the right path. It'll put you on the path towards blessings. The path of obedience, the path that is going to make things work out a whole lot better in your lives than if we go in that other direction. Because unfortunately, I've been in this direction too much, and I understand I'm much better off going in the right direction and doing what God has called me and created me to do in His kingdom. So God did create you for a plan and a purpose. If you're wondering that today, He did. And He loves you, and He's got great plans for you. He wants you to be successful. But if we'll change our minds with the Word, it'll change our hearts, and it'll change our actions. In verses 4 and 5, just as our bodies may have many parts, and each part has a special function, so it is with Christ's body. We are many parts of one body, and we all belong to each other. So your third point, as Christians, we are a part of the body of Christ, and each of us has a special role in the kingdom. And Paul talks about that even more in 1 Corinthians 12. I I'm going to turn over there to that, and I'm going to read that. I don't think we have that on the screens. I did that on purpose. So you have to actually maybe bring a Bible or look at your phone. I'm sneaky that way. So let's look at 1 Corinthians 12, verses 14 through 26, and I'm reading again from the New Living Translation. Yes, the body has many different parts, not just one part. If the foot says, I'm not a part of the body because I'm not a hand, that does not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear says, I'm not a part of the body because I am not an eye, would that make it any less a part of the body? If the whole body were an eye, how would you hear? Or if the whole body were an ear, how would you smell anything? But our bodies have many parts, and God has put each part just where he wants it. How strange a body would be if it had only one part. Yes, there are many parts, but only one body. The eye can never say to the hand, I don't need you. The head can't say to the feet, I don't need you. In fact, some parts of the body that seem weakest and least important are actually the most necessary. And the parts we regard as less honorable are those we clothe with the greatest care. So we carefully protect those parts that should not be seen, while the more honorable parts do not require the special care. So God has put the body together such that extra honor and care are given to those parts that have less dignity. This makes for harmony among the members, so that all the members care for each other. If one part suffers, all the parts suffer with it. And if one part is honored, all the parts are glad. Now, we all have a part to play. We're all important in the kingdom of God. You know, in verse 6, he talks about in his grace, God has given us different gifts for doing certain things well. And your fourth fill in the blank is God has given you at least one gift to serve in his kingdom. Most of us have many more gifts than that, but you probably have one main gift that you're passionate about, one gift that excites you, you know, and we're all made up of different things. Not everybody has the gifting to come up here and sing and lead the worship like Ashley and to be able to play the instruments in the band. I couldn't do that. I don't have that gifting, that talent and ability. If I did that, y'all would run out of here with your ears bleeding. So I'm not going to do that to you. I know where I fit into the body of Christ. So that's the challenge today is where do you fit? Are you a foot? Do you support? Are you eyes that you can see? Do you have a smile that you can smile and encourage others? What are the things that you can do? Do you have talents, gifts, and abilities? And right now I've got a helper that I'm going to ask to come up here. Chucky Blaylock is going to come up here, and he's in our young adult class. He's very faithful. Let's give this young man a hand clap here. Thank you, Chucky. How are you? Good. He's very faithful. Very faithful to come to our young adult class, and he's just very outgoing and very good supporter of our church. I just wanted to ask him a few questions. So, Chucky, if I give you this card right here, and I ask you to fill out that card, do you think you could do that for me?
Yeah.
That's not too hard, is it? Not too big of an ask. You can put your name, put your phone number, put your email address on there. That's not tough. And then that bottom question, it says, where will I serve or where I will serve? You know, do you think maybe that you could get up here and do like Ashley next Sunday? Could you lead the worship? No, that's a no then. We know that's a no. That's not your gifting, your talent, and ability. Can you go out and maybe build a new stage or do something like that, build some tables and a cross like Brother Chuck? You think you could possibly do that? Well, you got some talent then. I couldn't do that. I know one thing that you're really good at. You seem to be an encourager. You smile a lot. You're very friendly. Do you think maybe one Sunday every 6 weeks, you can stand at the front door here and greet somebody and shake their hand and say, hey, it sure is good to see you today. Thank you for coming to Crossroads Service. Here's a bulletin. Can I answer any questions for you? You think you can do that? Awesome. We found a place for you to serve today. Congratulations. Let's give him a hand clap. That's what we're talking about. We're talking about what can you do. Not everybody can do everything, and that's understandable. But just talking to him for a few minutes, we found a few things that he could possibly do to help serve here in the church, some things that I wouldn't have known about. So we're going to talk about the gifts that are listed in Scripture now. And if you wanted to write in the details, you can, but I didn't put those in the notes. But these are different gifts that are listed in the Word of God. You've got prophecy, and that's a Greek word that was translated prophesying or prophecy. In passages properly, it means to speak forth, to declare the divine will, to interpret the purposes of God, or to make known in any way the truth of God, which is designed to influence people. You know, you talk about the prophets in the Old Testament, thus saith the Lord God, this is going to happen. You know, you don't hear a lot of that today in our society, but you have an ability to prophesy. Serving, also referred to as ministering, and a lot of us have this gifting and this ability. We should be able to be like the Greek word diakonos, from which we get the English deacon, meaning service of any kind, the broad application of practical help to those in need. Many of us in this room can serve. Teaching, that's a little different gift. You've got to have more of a love for the Word of God, and this involves the analysis and proclamation of the Word of God, explaining the meaning, context, and application to the hearer's life. This gifted teacher is one who has the unique ability to clearly instruct and communicate knowledge, specifically the doctrines of the faith, or to tell some corny jokes every now and again. Hopefully that's not a part of it. I'll just put that in there. Don't look at me like that. Encouraging, also called exhortation. This gift is evident in those who consistently call upon others to heed and follow God's truth, which may involve correction or building others up by strengthening weak faith or comforting in trials. You know, many of us could exhort and encourage others. You know, and many of us at times need to be exhorted and encouraged. We can get down. It's easy to get down and to get a little bit depressed in this life. So that might be a gifting that you have. Giving. Gifted givers are those who joyfully share what they have with others, whether it's financial, material, or the giving of personal time and attention. The giver is concerned for the needs of others and seeks opportunities to share goods, money, and time with others as needs arise. You know, and think about this too. If God has really blessed you financially, do you think that's accidental? Do you think that God gave you all of that so that you, you know, for no reason at all? He's given you that ability to be able to bless the kingdom, to be able to help others. You've got more of an ability financially than other people who may not have as much in the resources area. Then leadership. A gifted leader is one who rules, presides over, or has the management of other people in the church. The word literally means guide and carries with it the idea of one who steers a ship like a captain. One with a gift of leadership rules with wisdom and grace and exhibits the fruit of the Spirit in his or her life as he or she leads by example. We've got many gifted leaders in this church. We've got all kinds of people who lead on the different committees and the different things that are done here in the church and give us guidance. And that's a very important gift if you have that gift of leadership. One of the reasons I love Pastor Jeff is that he leads by example. You know, during the Fair Booth week, he was in here daily, it seemed like, making chicken and dumplings. He was back here, he had his apron on. Man, he was rolling the dough out, he was cutting it out, doing whatever you had to do to get it ready for the Fair Booth. And then on top of that, he would even go out to the Fair Booth and serve at night, wouldn't he, Will? And I mean, it was just, you don't understand maybe sometimes how blessed we are here to have that kind of a true servant leader. Because that is a true leader. If you will lead by example, that's exactly what Jesus did. You know, he got down, he took his robe off, and he put the towel around his waist, and he washed his disciples' feet. He served others, and that's the example that we should be. We should be serving others. And if you want to be a leader, that means you got to be a servant. Mercy gift, closely linked with the gift of encouragement. The gift of mercy is obvious in those who are compassionate toward others who are in distress, showing sympathy and sensitivity coupled with a desire and the resources to lessen their suffering is a kind and cheerful manner. You know, we've got so many with the mercy gift here. I've seen it with the funerals. I've seen it with the sicknesses and things that go on. I mean, when we have a funeral, we have somebody pass away, this room is transformed, and there are tables put out and chairs put out and a buffet line that would rival any restaurant put up over here with as much food as you can imagine. And it's a comfort to the families. They can come in and they receive that mercy and they receive that blessing of the food. The word of wisdom, the fact that this gift is described as the word of wisdom indicates it's one of the speaking gifts. This gift describes someone who can understand and speak forth biblical truth in such a way as to skillfully apply it to life situations with all discernment. Word of knowledge, this is another speaking gift, involves understanding truth with an insight that only comes by revelation from God. Those with the gift of knowledge understand the deep things of God and the mysteries of his word. And believe me, that takes the next one, which is faith. If you ever get that whisper from the Holy Spirit, you get that feeling and impression in your mind, I need to speak to this person about this, or I need to bless this person, you're really stepping out there, you know, and especially if it's a word that you feel like God has given you about that person, it takes faith to step out, to trust the Holy Spirit to go forward with that. And then faith. All believers possess faith in some measure. You know, either a baby in Christ or you're more mature and you've got even more faith. Because it's a fruit of the Spirit. It's bestowed on all who come to Christ in faith. Galatians 5 is the chapter you can find that in, the fruit of the Spirit. The spiritual gift of faith is exhibited by one with a strong and unshakable confidence in God, his word, his promises, and the power of prayer to effect miracles. Healing, you know, God heals according to his plan and purpose. Some people have the gifting to pray for others in faith for healing, but it's God who ultimately is going to heal or doesn't heal. And when we pray and ask for that healing, we pray in faith. We ask that people be healed. You know, the good news is the Christian every time is going to be healed. Even when we pass into eternity, we're healed. We're completely healed. No more pain, no more suffering. We're going to end up with a new body someday. It's going to be perfect. No problems, no pain, no heartache. Ecclesiastes 3, verses 1 and 2 says, "For everything there is a season, a time for every activity under heaven, a time to be born, and a time to die." We all have that appointment. We all have that appointment. If God tarries, he doesn't come back and set up his kingdom here on the earth with the millennial reign, we're all going to have that appointment. You know, 100 years from now, there won't be many of us still alive in this room. We'll stand in his presence. The next gift, working of miracles. It's another gift involved performing supernatural events that can only be attributed to the power of God. And you look at the book of Acts, it's full of them. From Acts 2 to Acts 19, Acts 3, Acts 6, Acts 8, you see all kinds of examples. Then you see discerning of spirits, certain individuals possess the unique ability to determine the true message of God from that of the deceiver, from the enemy, from Satan, whose methods include purveying deceptive and erroneous doctrine. Jesus said many would come in his name and would deceive many in Matthew 24, but the gift of discerning spirits is given to the church to protect it from such as these. And that person has got to know the Word of God, because the Word of God is always going to line up. It's going to discern. It's going to tell us the truth about whether something is from the enemy and it's trying to harm us, or whether it's something that's from God. And then these other gifts, we don't know a lot about those or see those much anymore. Speaking in tongues, the gifts of tongues is the gifts given to the early church to enable the gospel to be preached throughout the world to all nations and in all known languages. It evolved the divine ability to speak in languages previously unknown to the speaker. This gift authenticated the message of the gospel, and those who preached it as coming from God. And then if it happens, it has to be interpreted according to the Word of God. You have interpretation of tongues. A person with the gift of interpreting tongues understands what a tongue speaker says, even though they don't know the language being spoken. The tongues interpreter then communicates the message of the tongue speaker to everyone else so all can understand. And the Word of God talks about that has to edify, has to build up others. It builds up the church. And then the last gift is the gift of helps. And this is closely related to the gift of mercy and the gift of helps. Those with the gift of helps are those who can aid or render assistance to others in the church with compassion and grace. This has a broad range of possibilities for application. Most importantly, this is a unique ability to identify those who are struggling with doubts, fears, and other spiritual battles, to move toward those in spiritual need with a kind word and understanding and compassionate demeanor, and to speak spiritual truth that is both convicting and loving. And then that takes me to verse 9 and verse 10. Romans 12. Don't just pretend to love others, really love them. Hate what is wrong, hold tightly to what is good, love each other with genuine affection, and take delight in honoring each other. Man, if we just did verses 9 and 10, if you don't get anything else out of this this preaching and teaching today, if we could get that. Don't pretend to love others, really love them. Love each other with genuine affection. And your fifth point, love is the greatest gift that we receive and that we can give as well. If we could just give love. You know, our band's going to come up, and Ashley's going to come up, and we're going to close with some music here. We're going to close with some song, and I've got a few more verses, and then I've got a challenge for you, and we're going to close out the service. The world needs to see the love of Jesus Christ in us, in his body, in his church, in us. The world has to see it. They're not going to see it from anyone else. And we're going to see that true, genuine love of Jesus Christ. So it's up to us to take our light and let it shine, to let people see the goodness of Christ, because it's not us, it's what he's done in us. So never be lazy, verse 11, but work hard and serve the Lord enthusiastically. Rejoice in our confident hope. Be patient in trouble and keep on praying. When God's people are in need, be ready to help them. Always be eager to practice hospitality. And that's your sixth point, your last fill in the blank. As Christians, we should work hard and serve God enthusiastically. Always look for ways to help others. You know, when I started serving the church, I was around 36 years old. You know, I've been in church all my life. I grew up, I got saved at 7, and been in and out of church, you know, all my life. I never really served. I never really did anything until the last church I went into, and then I was a police officer, and they had a security team, and I started doing what I did naturally, which was protect others, and started serving on their mission events that they had at the church, and started serving when they had worship services and making sure that people were safe, that the children were safe, that the property was protected. you know, I started doing those things, and then I started seeing the inner workings of church. I started seeing how things went on behind the scenes and how the services were set up and how things were happening. And then one thing led to another, and I felt the call to ministry. You know, and I struggled with that, wrestled with it a little bit, ended up leaving law enforcement, jumping into the church world. And I believe it was all because I started serving and I started getting involved in what was going on the campus. And that started giving me more of a burden for protecting people and being involved in the ministry. And that led me to where I am today here with you guys. So, you know, if I hadn't jumped in and I hadn't started serving, I might not be here today because that helped transform my life. Well, today, you've got a choice. You got this card, this fancy card with a logo on it. It's like giving, it's a matter of the heart. You can take that card and you can stick it in your Bible and make a bookmark out of it. Or you can take a pen and you put your name on there like Chucky said he could do, and his phone number and his email. And then you can put on there, where will I serve? Well, where could you serve? We got a youth director right here that would love to have some more people to come out and to volunteer and to help. We got a kitchen over here if you can cook. We got all kinds of folks that like to help in there. On Thursday night, we feed the community. There's an opportunity to come out. Even if you can't cook, they set up, they tear down, they do things to reach out to the less fortunate. Every Wednesday night, we have a meal here. We have children that are always singing. We've got the choir going on. We've got stuff that you can get involved with if you like kids, from the nursery to changing diapers. I know there's many of us that enjoy changing diapers. So glad I'm past that stage in my life. But if you do, you have that gifting for that. You can come and do that. Stephen would love to have your help throughout the week on maintenance. He's getting ready to fight the fall leaves. So if anybody likes to go out and blow the leaves off and clean out the exterior of the property, there's always a need for that. Mary Patterson, who cleans the church, would love to have any assistance. If you'd like to come in, scrub a commode, if you really enjoy that and stay behind the scenes, you can do that. There's so many things that could be done, from the women's ministry to the men's ministry. There's so many different areas. If you could just fill this out, put where you'd be willing to serve, or maybe anywhere. Maybe you don't know. You say, I'm willing to serve anywhere. We're needed. If you'll do that, if you'll bring that up here, just lay it on the altar at the end of the service. If you'll come up, give it to me. I'd love to have it. I'd love to pray with you if you have any prayer requests, if you have any needs. Maybe you're here today as the band plays. If you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, that today could be your day of salvation. Maybe today you think, you know, I've heard a lot about the Word. I've heard a lot about loving others, but I've never really driven my stake in the ground. I've never really given my heart, life, and emotions to Jesus. Today could be your day. I'm just going to ask every head to be bowed, every eye to be closed. And just pray a prayer like this if you've been sort of convicted and you say, I need to give Jesus my life. Say, Father God, I know I'm a sinner. I acknowledge my sin. Forgive me of my sins. Today I ask Jesus into my life. Today I make Jesus my Lord and my Savior. From this day forward, I will follow you. I'll be a disciple of Christ and I'll serve you. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. If you prayed that prayer, how do you know that you meant it? Jesus said, if you'll profess me before man, I'll profess you before my Father who is in heaven. But if you deny me before man, I'll deny you before my Father who is in heaven. So if you just slip up your hand right now and say, David, I prayed that prayer and I meant it. Nobody else is looking. I'm the only one in here. If you just lift your hand, I see that. Amen. Amen. I see those hands. Bless you. Bless you. I see that hand. You can put them down. I'd love to pray with you. I'd love to know a little bit more about your story. If you want to come up during this song, I'll pray with you, encourage you. Or if you want to stay after, I'd love to meet you and talk to you about the decision you just made. If you need prayer physically, relationally, emotionally, spiritually, or financially, don't wait. Come on down to you during the song. And God bless you as we worship. If everybody would just stand now, we're going to worship God.
Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we only want to hear your voice. Hanging on every word. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we only wanna hear your voice. We're hanging on every word. When you speak, when you move, when you do what only you can do, it changes us. It changes what we see, what we receive when you come in the room, when you do what only you can do. It changes us, it changes what we see, and what we
after the service and lay them on the stage. I'd love to have them then. God bless you. Father God, I just thank you for this day. I thank you for your word. I thank you that you love us so much. We can't even comprehend how much you love us. God, I pray for each and every person that they go throughout their week, that they know they are the head and not the tail. They are above and not beneath. God, that they are more than conquerors through Christ Jesus, that you'll never leave us. You'll never forsake us. God, that you love us so much, that we're joint heirs to the throne of Christ. If we've accepted Jesus is Lord and Savior, that we'll be with you for eternity. So God, help us to utilize our gifts to go forward throughout this week, to reach others, to truly love others, and to show them how much Jesus Christ loves them. In your holy name we pray, amen and amen. You're dismissed.
We fall on our knees. When you fall, we fall. Amen.